my heart to victory. You are my strength, and you always will be. I see the evidence of your goodness all over my life, all over my life. I see promises in fulfillment all over my life, all over my life. Let's sing that again. See the cross, the empty grave, the evidence is endless. All my sins rolled away because of you, oh Jesus. Oh, I see the evidence of your goodness all over my life, all over my life. Promises in fulfillment all over my life, all over my life. Oh, I see the evidence of your goodness all over my life, all over my life. I see your promises in fulfillment
Yes, he is good. The evidence of his goodness, we can see it in our lives. And we just want to welcome you today to church. Thank you for coming out. Thank you for joining online. My name is Naya Fisher, and I serve as one of the worship leaders here. And we just want to welcome you today. We've got a wonderful, wonderful service. We'll be singing some worship, entering into the presence of God. And when we were talking with our dream team before the service started, we shared how when two or three gather in a place, in the name of Jesus, Jesus said, I am there with them. And so as we begin to shift our attention and focus on our God, our Savior, Jesus Christ, he comes and he fills this place. And we want to receive from God, but not just receive, we want to be able to minister to God as we sing his praise and his glory that he deserves. And so that's what we're doing today. We just invite you to be a part of that. We have the words on the screen. Please join in and sing with us. If you're watching at home, just set the atmosphere where you're at. Turn the lights down if you need to. Turn the volume up. Bring the family around and set the example. Mothers, fathers who are watching at home, set the example for your kids by singing and joining in and worship. Amen. Let's continue to praise and worship.
But he brought me in, though me read this scripture from Philippians 3, verse 20 that says, "But we are citizens of heaven, and we can hardly wait for a Savior from there. He is the Lord Jesus Christ." You know, a citizen is a person who legally belongs to a country. A citizen is governed by the rules and the laws of the country. And every human being is born into a kingdom of this world. But when we are born again by faith in Jesus, we are born into the kingdom of heaven. We are no longer of this world, but we become a citizen of an eternal kingdom where our Father God is the King. Isn't that amazing?
Yes, hallelujah.
He didn't stop there. Not only did we acquire a new citizenship, but a new identity.
Yes.
And that identity resides in knowing ourselves in Christ and living with the confidence of knowing you are who God says you are.
Yes.
And in John 15, 16 says, "You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you that your fruit should abide, so that whatever you ask the Father in my name, he may give it to you." So you are chosen by God, who loves you deeply, a God who is for you and never against you, a God who has plans for you to prosper, a God who wants a relationship with you, and a God who will never let you down. So let's focus our eyes towards eternal things and storing up treasure in heaven. We consider ourselves ambassadors to this earth. So let's praise God for giving you and me that privilege to be called His child, and for making us citizens of heaven. And as we sing these lines again, let us sing it from our heart and have that confidence to declare that I am chosen, that you are who God says you are.
Not against me. I am who you say I am.
I am chosen.
I am chosen. For me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken.
Say I am.
You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am who you say I am. I am who you say I am. Child of God, yes I am.
Oh, Father's house, there's a place for me.
Yes I am.
Let's just take a moment and be filled up in the presence of God.
Oh, fill us up, Lord. Fill us up with your Spirit. We want more of you. Oh, we want more of you, God. 'Cause you chose us, you picked us up. We sing a new song to you, yes. A loving Father, you never leave us or forsake us. We're never alone, we're never alone.
Jesus, be lifted high in this place, be lifted high in this place, 'cause you're the name above all names. We pour our love on you, God, we pour it out on you.
Let's just lift up our hands and pour out our love on him. Just say, I love you, Jesus. I worship you, Jesus. You're the only one I seek and desire. You're the only one that I bow to and give my life to. It's to you, Jesus. It's to you, Jesus. There's no other one but you.
Jesus, I forsake you. We love you, Jesus. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. 'Cause I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say.
Sing it one more time.
'Cause I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. Yes,
I am. We choose to believe that we are who you say that we are, God. We are loved by you. And we just turn our affection towards you right now. We just thank you for your Holy Spirit, who's ever with us, ever present, or ever present help in time of need. We thank you that he's moving in this place, God. Holy Spirit, have your way in this service. Have your way through the message in our hearts, in our minds, and show us new things that we've never seen before from your word. We thank you for that, Father God. And in the mighty name of Jesus, we all say together, amen. Amen. As we go from this place of worship, we love to just greet somebody, give a big smile and wave to at least two people, and you may be seated.
Imagine this rope, okay, pretend this rope just goes on forever. Now imagine that this rope is a timeline of your existence. You just exist forever. You see this red part? This would represent your time on earth. You've got a few short years here on earth, and then you've got all of eternity somewhere else. And what blows me away is some of you, all you think about is this red part. It's all you think about. You're consumed with this. You go, oh man, I can't wait till here. You know, I'm gonna work hard, I'm gonna save so I can really enjoy this part right here. And you're consumed with that, and you're thinking, oh man, am I gonna get to travel? Am I gonna eat well? Am I gonna do this during this part? And I'm like, are you kidding me? What about this? What about all this stuff? It's crazy to me, because the Bible teaches that what I do during this little red part determines how I'm going to exist for millions and millions and millions of years forever. And so why would I spend this little red part trying to make myself as comfortable as possible, enjoying myself as much as I can? Paul says, look, I'm going to live my life for this mission. I'm going to spend my life, invest my life for this moment when I cross that finish line.
See, I'm going to forget about all this stuff I could enjoy, and I'm not going to look around. I'm going to be like a runner, just looking at that moment when I face God, because when I face Him, then I don't get this chance over again. We get one chance at this life on earth, and it can end at any second for any of us. We've got one chance at this, and then comes eternity. You see, people look at some of my decisions and go, oh, you're so stupid because that's going to really affect this. I go, no, you're stupid because that's going to affect all of this. Man, I'm serious. I look at the way people live and I go, wow, that is so crazy. You are so crazy. You're going to do that right now, just to enjoy right now, not even knowing if you have tomorrow, and you think that's smart and that I'm dumb?
Praise God. What a powerful, powerful message. Man, if you weren't awake when this service started, you better be awake after watching that video. It's a kind of a reality check for us here in the church, in our lives, of what are we truly living for. And we're going to talk about this a little bit in our sermon today. But I'd just like to welcome everybody. Thanks for coming out. And Pastor Steve and Sharman are out of town. They are on their way back soon, should be back hopefully this week. They had to extend their stay due to a testing positive for COVID, but they're doing well, and we look forward to seeing them back very soon. But we're just going to jump right into our series, Summer at Faith Family, where we have different subjects that we like to talk about throughout this summer and highlight areas that really we feel like God is wanting to speak. And we've kind of been on a theme these last few weeks, I don't know if you've noticed, which is kind of taking control of your life, taking control of your decisions, your actions, you know, kind of waking up again after a few years of being kind of told, well, you can't do this and you can't do that and you can't go here and you can't be here too long. You can't be with that person too long because of various restrictions and all that. And I don't need to get into all that. You know what I'm talking about. But it's time, especially as the body of Christ, that we rise up and begin to lead and lead our life, and not just our life, but help lead the people around us. Because right now, more than ever, the world is in need of leaders. People are searching for hope. They're searching for answers. And you might even be searching for hope and an answer. And you can relate exactly to what we're saying here. But as a body of Christ, we have some insight into some things because we understand how the world really works. The world really works by the hand of God. He's the one who created the world. He's the one who sent Jesus to die for our sins and raised Him up again so that anyone who calls on His name will be saved. That's the concept, the right concept of this world. And when we understand that, that's the number one foundation that we need as an individual to be able to live a life that is effective, live a life that is a blessing to other people, which is what God ultimately desires from all of us. So basically everybody, and I would believe everybody here in this room and those watching online, would feel like, I want to do something to help change the situations around me. You might see things in your family or in your job that are just not quite where they need to be yet. Or maybe in your city as you walk around, you see things that grieve your heart. And I wish I could fix this. I wish I could change that. There's this kind of desire inside of us to change things for the better. So that's not the issue. The issue is when it comes to actually doing it, actually making it happen. Because the problem is most people don't change their present or future situations because they think they either can't do anything about it or they just don't know how. And unfortunately, most people just kind of accept the things that are happening around them as fact, as the reality, and we just have to go along with what's happening around us. And I want to put this powerful statement up. It says, when you simply accept the things that are happening to you in life, You are living a life that is unworthy of your ability and your calling, and you are missing out on the greatest feeling of fulfillment, having made a difference with your life. So I'm here to encourage you today, don't just accept the things that are happening around you. Step up and be a leader to change it. John Maxwell, we're going to look at a number of his quotes today, but he says this: leadership is not about titles, positions, or flowcharts. It is about one life influencing another life. And that's as simple as it can be. Leadership is influence. And you look at your life and you see the areas you have influence in. You might not feel like a leader, but I want to guarantee you something. There are areas in your life where you are influencing. And in those areas where you're influencing, whether it's as a parent to your kids or as a boss to your coworkers or however it might be, you are leading people whether you know it or not. And we're going to look at three simple life course changers that really, I believe, by the end of this message, you'll have a greater insight to understand how you can take control, take a hold of the life that God has given you and move it in the right direction. And firstly, it's very important that you understand that your life is not a sprint. We're not on a race, on a treadmill, running as fast as we can, trying to get through life in a hurry. Quick, get more money. Quick, get a better house. Quick, get that. That's so much of the pressure that we feel. Our life isn't a marathon. Our life is not a sprint. It's like a marathon. And you might feel like, well, I could never run a marathon. But the thing is, with running a marathon, we've all walked, it's 26 miles. We've all walked 26 miles before in our life. And the reason we could do that is because of the pace that we were using when we were walking. And so we must understand there is a pace that God wants you to be walking in your life. You might call it the pace of grace, the pace of God's grace on your life. And if you start to walk faster than what he's graced you to do, you're going to get tired and burned out and feel like I can never complete this race of the Apostle Paul calls our life like a race. I could never finish and receive the prize. But our pace is important. And understanding when you take one step at a time, one step after another step, and only think about what is the next thing I need to do, you'll look back one day and realize, man, I have traveled a long distance that I never thought I could do just because I just kept taking one step in the right direction. So our life course changer number one, lead yourself. John Maxwell, if you wouldn't follow yourself, why should anybody else? And how many of you know the hardest person that you'll ever lead is yourself? And that is so true. The most, and it's actually encouraging to know that the hardest person is that you'll ever try and lead is standing there looking at you in the mirror, because they're always with you. You when you lead other people, you have that moment of influence and then you go away, but yourself, you're always there and you're always having to kind of urge yourself, okay, let's go, let's get up, pick up yourself, encourage yourself. But we can do it. I want to put this statement up. It says, do not accept the things that just happen to you in life. Lead yourself by making small changes towards a life that is worthy of your ability and your calling. And you will enjoy the greatest feeling of fulfillment, having made a difference with your life. And I want to share with you some keys to leading yourself. And number one, which everybody here has already taken this step to do, and that's to seek God with all your heart. Seek God with all your heart. What does that mean? Well, if you never prioritize something with time, then it is truly no priority in your life. If we're truly going to be seeking God with all of our heart, we must be giving him time from our life. I see everybody here who has committed this time this morning to get to know God more, to strengthen their relationship with Jesus. And that's commendable. You guys are doing a wonderful, wonderful job seeking God. But This is really the foundation of being a truly successful leader in this world, is our relationship with God. And it's important to find one thing. We keep talking about next steps. We're really passionate about next steps at Faith Family Church. It's one of the, like, our key words. We just love using it because it's so simple. What is one thing in your relationship with Jesus where you can take an area of growth in it? It might be spending more time in the Word, maybe finding some way that works for you to listen to the audio Bible on your way to work. Maybe it's just saying a prayer right when you get up out of bed, just a simple prayer like, God, help me today. That's a prayer right there. I pray that one a lot. Sometimes I wake up and I'm just like not there. My wife knows it takes sometimes like 10 or 15 minutes for my brain to get off the pillow, even though my body is walking around like a zombie. But that's a prayer that you can start your day with, directing your attention and focus to God, and He's going to answer prayers like that. Whatever it is for you, how can you begin to grow in that relationship as you seek God with all your heart? Another area, when you're developing yourself as a leader, the hardest person that you'll ever lead is to keep growing. Never stop learning in some area of your life. In Proverbs 22, chapter 22, verse 29, it says, "Do you see someone who's skilled in their work? They will serve before kings, and they will not serve before officials of low rank." So you might miss it here, but it's talking about somebody who's skilled. And as much as it's talking about someone who's skilled, it's also talking about someone who's not skilled. Someone who's not skilled will not serve before kings, will not serve in great areas. Only those who are skilled, according to this scripture. And so we have an assignment to become skilled in the areas that God has called us to. And I've learned this myself in a particular area of my life, in the area of music. So I play the guitar and sing and play the piano, but it's taken many, many years to get to where I am now. And my wife thinks I'm like the greatest guitar player to ever live on the face of the earth in all of history. And that's a joke, by the way. But it wasn't like that, you know. You might think it was like that all the time, but it took a lot of hard work to get there. And I want to show you some pictures kind of like at the beginning of my musical journey. And this photo right here, oh, there I am. go to the one before. Yeah, there we go. So this was at an outreach we did in Shamshapo, Cheongshawan area at a park back in 2006. You see it says 2006 right there. And I go to the next photo. You can see me there with my guitar. It's actually the same guitar that I'm using right now. It's a nice guitar. Go to the next photo. You see JL right there. She's really young. She's now leading Faith Family Kids with a baby on the way and a husband, but she was probably like 9 years old right there. Go to the next photo. There we are. We had a team with us from America, so a number of about 40 youth joining this outreach event. Go to the next picture. See Pastor Sharman right there. So this picture is special to me. So if you see somebody, it's kind of like a Where's Waldo picture. There's somebody in here who you know very well, and if you notice that person standing on the right side of the screen with the orange t-shirt, that is my wife, Janice. And this is one of the very first photos that I've ever had of Janice. It's this picture right here. And this is the only picture in this whole outreach that we have her a picture in. It's kind of funny. But we had actually met during, you can take the pictures down now, but we had actually met during this outreach back in 2006 in the summer, because we were working with the church in Cheongshawan. And she happened to be working at a job that was just right next door to this church. So she saw all the activity going on. She wasn't a believer, but she saw me and just thought, again, like I was an angel from heaven. She instantly fell in love with me. And we kind of became really awkward friends, started texting, and it was just really, really awkward. And my parents didn't even know who she was when we first met. But she had given her heart to Jesus that summer through these outreaches we were doing. And this was probably the first event that she volunteered at to serve as as a new believer. But this is where kind of my musical journey started. I had only begun singing just literally 1 or 2 months before this. I had just turned 15 years old. And let me just tell you, I wasn't very good. Honestly, I was not good. And when I started playing the guitar, I only knew how to use one finger and just play one note at a time and just kind of move that finger up and down the guitar neck. And my parents made me start playing at church. I'm not sure why. But that's how I started out. And I had to learn very quickly that if I wanted to get better than what I was, I had to put some time in and start practicing. And I know you know what that means. I think people here are very, very good at practicing, very good at focusing on a task and working till it's done. But honestly, for me, you might think, oh, you must just love to practice the guitar and practice piano and sing. But quite honestly, one of the hardest things I feel like I've had to do is encourage myself to get to the point to go practice. Like, I don't know what it is. When I go to practice, I feel sleepy, feel sluggish, and like, oh man, I don't want to get my guitar. I get this, you get everything set up and plugged in. And for years and years and years and years, honestly, it's been like that. And it still is like that even now today. I have to like make myself stop and practice and get through it. And it's not always fun. Sometimes it is, but it's not always fun. But if I didn't do anything, I'd still be like that little 14, 15-year-old kid on the screen who didn't really know how to sing, who didn't really know how to play. And I'm not saying I'm there by any means. I'm still on a long, long journey ahead. But it took some time to practice and develop myself. And one area I was also able to develop my abilities was through help from other people who came into my life to help teach me. I want to show one more picture. I just love these guys. Go ahead and put up that next picture. This is Tony Jones Sr. and Tony Jones Jr. These two brothers are extremely, extremely talented on the keyboard. And when we would go to America, so we were living here most of my life, but we'd go to America for a month or two, and we would go to their city, and I would record them playing the piano for a few hours, and then take that video back to Hong Kong and just study it and practice for hours and hours and hours of what they kind of had imparted and taught to me. And it really totally transformed the way I see music and the way I play on the piano. And I'm incredibly grateful. Again, but this, it took effort. It took intentionality to make time to go be with people who are able to help see some areas that I needed help in to increase the skill in the area that I believe God has called me to. And so if we also look into the scripture, we'll see the Apostle Paul. He had a miraculous conversion on the road to Damascus. Jesus appeared to him. He received Jesus, received a calling for his life. But he didn't just jump out into leadership. He first spent time leading himself. And a lot of people don't realize this, but there was around a decade before Paul really started his public ministry that we read about in Acts. He was alone receiving revelation from Jesus Christ that he talks about later, and he had a mentor named Barnabas who was with him, helping him for many, many years, developing his skill, developing his knowledge of the Word of God before he stepped out and began to lead other people. And you might feel like, well, you've got that calling, Naya, in music, and Paul had his calling in teaching the Word of God. I just don't really feel that there's any area that I can focus on. Well, let me just help you out. Yeah, here's what I call the Big Five. And these areas, these five areas are areas you can always be growing and learning in continually throughout your entire life. And number one is marriage. Number two is parenting. Number three is your health, how to be healthy, live healthy. Number four is financial management. And finally, number five is faith. If you just pick one of those five areas and work on it for a month, work on it for a week, you're going to be growing in a very important area. And I like to call these the Big Five. I always try and figure out ways in my week to get a little nugget here and there touching in these five areas. So life course changer number two, Number one was lead someone else. Number one is lead yourself. Number two is lead someone else. John Maxwell says again, a leader who produces other leaders multiplies their influences. So how do you lead somebody else? We'll look at this statement. When you help someone else to not simply accept the things that happen to them in life, but help them to live a life that is worthy of their ability and their calling, you will watch them enjoy the greatest feeling of fulfillment, having made a difference with their life. And I want to show this one more scripture, Proverbs chapter 27, verse 17. And I think everybody knows this one. As iron sharpens iron, so one friend sharpens another friend. So you see, as you begin to develop yourself, you're going to be able to start leading other people. And just take a step back here. Remember what we're talking about. Remember this video that we watched at the beginning. We're taking hold of our life again and saying, no, these are my priorities. I'm not just going to be focused on the little red part of the temporary that I see right now. I'm going to focus on the eternal and my eternal destiny with Jesus Christ in heaven. And so it's so important we develop our skills to the point where we can lead other people and influence other people. And kind of just continuing on in this example from my own life in the area of music, I want to show another photo, and I hope the worship team is okay with this. I didn't ask anybody, but go ahead and put that other picture. This is from our worship team Zoom call just a few nights ago. We were all gathered together. So first of all, I don't know if everybody realizes it or not, but the worship team doesn't just show up on Sunday and play the music and then do nothing during the week. This team spends hours every single week preparing naturally, preparing spiritually to make the worship experience as best as it can possibly be. I just want to give them a hand clap, just honor their commitment. But what was happening in this call is we were strategizing. How can we make worship better? What can we do, whether it's a spiritual thing, whether it's a natural, practical thing? And in this moment, I was able to kind of lead our team to see some things that we can do to help everyone engage in worship even more. But this came through this journey that we're talking about of leading yourself to get to a point where you can lead others to something great. And life course changer number three is lead with someone else. If you're a leader, the true measure of your success is not getting people to work. It's not getting people to work hard. It's getting people to work hard together. And that takes commitment. So how do I lead with someone else? Let's put up this next statement. Find a group of people that do not want to simply accept the things that happen to them in life, but are working to live a life that is worthy of their abilities and their callings. Then join them and work with them to accomplish something that will make a difference that you could not do alone. And one more scripture to follow this up. Proverbs chapter 13, verse 20 says, whoever walks with the wise becomes wise, but the companion of fools will suffer harm. So there's a difference between leading someone and leading with someone. It almost sounds like it's the same thing, but it's actually not. And God's wanting you to do both. We need to be doing both to accomplish the things that he has for us in our life. Because there are people that God wants to bring alongside you that have gifts and abilities that will support your gifts and abilities. And together, you can do something great for God. And just continuing on in this story of my journey in music, for years it's been on my heart to record an album in Chinese, worship music in Chinese. And if you rewind back to when I was about 10 or 11 years old, we were at a church in America, and I met a friend. His name was Spencer Boyce, and he was about the same age as me. Just starting out, I had barely known how to play an instrument, and he was about the same. But fast forward 20 years later, this friend had grown in his musical skill, become a producer, producing many Christian worship albums, and myself as well, in a totally different, similar but different area of worship in Chinese and practicing and learning how to sing in Mandarin, which we'll do here at church, was also developing my skill until one day God put something on his heart a few years ago, and he called me and just kind of out of the blue, like, hey, Naya. And we got talking, and he said God had put on his heart to record worship music in Mandarin Chinese. And it's like, hey, that's what's on my heart too. Isn't that funny? What have you been doing for the last 20 years? Oh, I've been producing Christian worship albums. So I know how to do it, but I don't know how to speak Mandarin Chinese. What have you been doing for the last 20 years, Naya? Oh, I've been practicing singing Chinese to record an album. It's like, oh, okay, why don't we do this together? And so after some prep time, about a year of getting some things ready, it became a reality. Got just a few photos I want to show. And October 2019, Spencer Boyce is right there in the middle, and our friend Austin Ludwig, who came out to help record this album. Go to the next photo. We set up like a home studio recording. He brought some gear from America, and we captured the vocals, laid down some basic tracks with the instruments. You can go to the next photo here. We've got some church, we had some church members come in to help record some of the background vocals. So we captured all that in about a week here in Hong Kong. That he returned to America, got some of his other producer friends to help in with the album, and about 6-7 months later, we finally had the finished product. You can put the artwork up there. Not that one, the picture of the heart. The album, Here in Your Love. And this album right now is available all around the world, anywhere you can find music. And what really excites me is it's also in China on the Chinese streaming services for people to access, where it's very difficult to get Christian music. And all this came about because two people were seeking God, were leading themselves to be able to practice, be able to grow and excel in our gifts, to leading other people around us. And finally, God did the work in connecting two people together to say, look, this is something that you can do together now that you would not be able to do if you were apart. And so I hope that encourages you. And I want you to know there was a lot of challenges along the way. Even with recording this album, like we literally, at one point I wrote a message and my thumb was hovering over the send button, which was gonna cancel the whole thing, to postpone it into 2020. Little did we know that was the year of COVID, and we probably wouldn't have even had done it to this day. I was about to send it, and I just got a little check in my heart. I don't know, that doesn't feel right. Thank God we didn't send it. Talk to my wife. Good to have a good wife who knows God. But there were moments like that throughout this whole journey where it could have been stalled. It could have not happened. It was difficult, discouraging. But we just keep on pressing through, knowing, like we talked about life being a race. It's just about one step after another step after another step. And you'll look up one day and realize, wow, look where God has brought me. Look where God has brought me as I've begun to lead in the areas that I can in my life. And you can be a part of something bigger than you, with people who have the same heart as you do to accomplish something great that you couldn't do by yourself. And I just really hope this sticks with you so clearly. Don't simply accept the things that are happening to you in life. Take control. Take authority in the name of Jesus. Begin to speak his word over your life. You want to take control of your life. Begin to speak what God said about you over you. Speak what he said about you over your situation. You know, just think about it for a moment. Would you ever talk to someone else the way that you talk to yourself sometimes? We can be so brutal in condemning and criticizing and discouraging ourselves. We'd never, how long would you have a friend if we talked to that friend the way we so often talk to ourselves? You wouldn't be friends very long. So how about taking control by speaking what God says? I am who you say I am, not who the world says I am, not even who I say I am. I am who God says I am. And God says I am a leader and have called you to great things. So you might feel like, well, this sounds really great, but I don't even know Jesus yet. I don't have a personal relationship with him. I haven't taken that first step. And I just want to encourage you, that's something you can do right now, today. Commit your heart to Jesus. Give him your life, and he will change you on the inside, making you into a brand new person, it says in the Bible. And just by simply calling out on Jesus. So I'd like to ask everyone to just close their eyes right now, and we're going to pray a simple prayer. Wherever you are, if you're watching online, please join us in this prayer. And I'd like to ask everyone to also join us so that no one would be praying alone. And pray this out of your heart. Dear Lord Jesus, I know that I am a sinner and that I am lost. Right now, I ask you to forgive me for my sin. I believe that you died for me, Jesus, and that God raised you from the dead. Right now, I turn from my old life. I ask you to be my Lord and Savior. Thank you for saving me and making me a part of your family. Amen. Amen. Well, if you prayed that for the first time, that's so wonderful. We're so excited for you. And we love to help you take your next step. And so we've got connection cards right here on the seats, or if you're watching online, there's a link right below in the video description where you can just reach out and let us know the decision that you've made today and give us as much information as you would feel comfortable. And we want to help you take a new step in your relationship with God, because life is really a spiritual journey. We have our core values, and there's a reason we put them up every single week to remind us about this spiritual journey we're on and that we're walking together and that we need help from others to complete. And it starts with knowing God, having a personal relationship with him, which we do by committing our lives to Jesus like we just did. So just so thankful for anyone who would have prayed that for the first time today or rededicated their life to Jesus in that way. We're going to go on to our prayer experience where we can just pray from our heart and worship a little bit more as we dedicate our life to God to be a leader. So I'd just like to invite Pastor Janice to the stage.
As Pastor Naya said, leadership is all about influence. And as a Christian, we have the privilege to position ourselves to do the plans of God and make the most positive influence in someone else's life through prayer. I want to share, you know, how one night after we said goodnight to our kids, we usually pray with them. We put them in bed by 7, and after we said goodnight to them, we start hearing some noise or sound in the kids' room, and we realized Asa would start bursting out praying in the spirit, singing a new song, and leading Gemma Taya, and having a mini worship service like in their bum bed. It was a joy watching them to do it, to lead themselves in the presence of God. And I believe because we as parents first lead ourselves to make our family priorities right. And prayer is our priority. We pray together. We pray in front of our kids, pray with them on their way to school. They wouldn't even go to school without us praying with them. And I'm not saying we have done this right all the time. We sometimes forget, sometimes we're too lazy, sometimes we will procrastinate. And that's why it's very important for you to surround yourself with people that love God and that will speak truth in your life. I'm looking out here, some of the parents, and some of our small group leaders have inspired us and challenged us in ways that we would not have if we were on our own. And I remember I heard a metaphor of that compare prayers to flashlight. You know, when you shine a flashlight, it will go as far as you can see. But it will only go farther when we would take a step further. If we always remain in the same distance, that's all you can see. And I think it's the same in our spiritual walk and our prayer life. It takes faith and discipline to lead yourself to go further, or else we'll always remain the same and we'll never get to see what God has for us at the end of the road. So in a couple of weeks, 21 days of prayer will be happening, and I really encourage you all to start thinking about it and plan to participate. If you're parents, I want you to include your kids. And quoting what Pastor and I were saying, lead yourself by making small change toward a greater goal, and eventually you will have more and more to offer. You'll be able to lead someone, and you'll be able to live with others. Right now, I want you all to stand up to pray, and we have our prayer point on the screen. I just want to do something different. Host team and our care team member or small group leader, why don't you pray with the person next to you? If you see anyone who's standing on their own, why don't you go stand next to them and just pray for each other? And after we pray, we're gonna go worship for a couple more minutes. Okay. Don't be shy. Just go stand next to someone and pray for one another. We are not meant to do this on our own.
Yes,
this is why God created the church for. Yay, Heavenly Father,
yes,
we pray for leaders and all those in authority, just like your Bible, just like the Bible says, so that we may live peaceful and quiet lives in all godliness and holiness. Make us effective in our sphere of influence and open new doors for us to be able to make impact and reach even more people for your glory. Give us a heart to make a difference in the lives of people we have never reached out to before, and bonus to walk in obedience to your calling. As we grow, help us to be a good steward of the responsibility you have entrusted to us. Lord, we're desperate for your presence. We're desperate for your presence in our life. The same Spirit who raised Jesus from the dead lives in us, and through the power of your Spirit, I pray that you will help us to be succeed in the opportunity that you have given us. We ask you for open doors. And as we walk out the purpose you have for our life, I pray that you will stop any and every attack of the enemy. Lord, protect our body, our mind, and our emotion. And I pray that you will protect our family and community from harm. We know that the one who is in us is greater than the one who is in the world. We pray for greater territory to impact for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Let's pray in the Spirit for a couple minutes. Thank you, Father. If you know how to pray in the Spirit, I encourage you to pray it out loud.
And I worship you for
Let us know by sending us a WhatsApp message or fill out the form online at www.faithfamilyhk.com, and we'll be praying for you. Pastor Nat.
Praise God. You may be seated. What a wonderful time of prayer. We're talking about leading today, and we want to end with some next steps. One of those is to begin to worship God with our tithes and with our offerings. We want you to know, if you're new here, maybe you just joined us online for the first time, there's no pressure to give. We want something for you today, not something from you. But in terms of leading, when we lead with our finances by giving God our first 10%, the Bible calls it the first fruits. You just picture that right now. That 10% is leading the 90% into the blessing of God in our lives. If you read the New Testament, the Old Testament, anywhere God talks about us giving to Him, it's filled with His blessing in return. It's just a fact of who God is. But we can lead our own finances by honoring God with the 10%, with the tithe, the first fruits, and we will be blessed for it. So I just encourage you, if maybe you haven't ever done that, take that step today. Or if you've done it a little bit, maybe get something recurring going, get it a habit, get it built into your life. So if you did come prepared to give today, you can do that on faithfamilyhk.com/give. We've got the giving kiosk right there in the back. Bank transfer, credit card, whatever's convenient for you. We just thank you for being faithful. We have a generous church with generous people that God is helping to be free, set free from the hold of money. And so it's so wonderful to see. I also want to highlight something we talked about last week, which is our Acts of Kindness cards. We've got these in the back there. And we shared last week how you can be a blessing to somebody with one of these cards by like paying for a meal for somebody and leaving this there so that they would see it and know that God loves them. There's so many ways that you can use this card. Just let your imagination run wild. I mean, infinite possibilities. But it's so important as a church that we begin to be the hands and feet of Jesus. Let people know that Jesus loves them through just simple acts of kindness like this. And the thing is, it's so easy to do. And you can do this so discreetly. You don't have to make a big scene. Nobody even has to know you were there. All they'll find is this card, and they know God loves them. And they even have an opportunity, if they wanted to take a step by visiting the church, learning more about Jesus, they could do that with the church website right here as well. So grab some of these. They're in the back. We'll be printing more and have even more next week. We're almost out of them. So make sure you get all the ones that are there, and we'll have more next week. So sorry if you're watching online. These only work in paper form, so you got to come in person to get them. So anyways, I just invite everybody to stand together. Thank you for coming out today. Pray you have a wonderful, wonderful week. Please just stick around in the back for a little bit of fellowship. And we'll have our Cantonese service at 12 o'clock. God bless you. You're dismissed.